Well, good evening, and welcome to our Good Friday Tenebrae service. The word Tenebrae comes from a Latin word that means shadows, and it represents the suffering and the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the center of the platform tonight is a Christ candle. It's the larger white candle, and it reminds us that Jesus was, is, and always will be the light of the world. Around it are seven other candles, and they represent the seven lessons of Good Friday. The service this evening is going to consist of some scripture readings from Matthew's gospel. Each lesson will be followed by a prayer, a song, and the extinguishing of a candle. And as the story unfolds of Christ's passion and death, the lights will gradually be dimmed to dramatize Christ's suffering. And after a final scripture is read, the Christ candle is going to be removed and taken out of the worship center to symbolize the burial of the light of the world. And I want to ask you to please remain seated and silent while that takes place, and while there is also the singing of a last song. And after that song, which is Were You There, is sung, there's nothing more to be said until Easter, when we celebrate that Jesus came alive forevermore. And so following that song, Were You There, the lights will be turned up ever so slightly, and I invite you to please leave silently and quietly without any announcement or benediction. And as much as possible, it will help the atmosphere and help us understand the significance of this day if we leave the building and wait until we're outside before we begin talking. I want to remind you tonight on Good Friday that Sunday is coming, and our Easter services will be held right here in this room at 7 a.m., 8:30 a.m., and 10 o'clock a.m. Let's pray. Holy and loving God, by the suffering and the death of your Son Jesus, you brought salvation to the whole world. And in your mercy, draw us to Christ lifted high on the cross. And by his redeeming love, raise us up to everlasting life with him. And this we pray in the name of Christ, who reigns with you in your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
To the cross I look, to the cross I cling, of the suffering I do drink. It's work I do sing. At the crown my Savior, both bruised and crushed, show that God is love and God is just. At the cross you you beckon me, you Draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost in love. I'm lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. He said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed a third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near. The Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Let's pray. Dear Lord, like the disciples, we find that oftentimes our spirit is willing, but our flesh is weak. Help us to keep watch and to pray so that we will not fall into temptation. Enable us to stay alert, so we can be obedient to your will, even as Jesus was during his agony in the night of the Garden of Gethsemane. May our eyes be focused on you and your holy purpose. In Jesus' name, amen.
I count it all as love. to the cross. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Friend, do what you came for." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus's companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him, "for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?" At that time, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him. Let's pray. Dear God, remind us that we are constantly being tempted to betray you and your ways. By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to avoid the trap that ensnared Judas and enable us to remain true to you and your commandments. Teach us also to pursue the way of peace and reconciliation that your Son taught his disciples to follow. This we pray in the strong name of Jesus, the one who commands the angels and the armies of heaven. Amen.
You stand and join me as we sing this hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. But they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'" Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. "But I say to all of you, in the future you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look now, you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? He is worthy of death," they answered. Then they spit in his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said, "Prophesy to us, Christ, who hit you?" Let us pray. Dear Father, on this night, we are reminded of the pain and humiliation that Jesus experienced on our behalf. Though he was without sin, he was mocked, spat upon, and beaten. Yet like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, he did not open his mouth. In such a way, he was wounded for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. But according to your sovereign plan, this punishment makes us whole, and by his bruises, we are now healed. We thank you for the price that Jesus paid, and we dedicate our lives anew to his service. Amen.
Oh, Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priest and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony that they're bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply. Not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now it was the governor's custom at the feast to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew it was out of envy that they had handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message: "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ?" Pilate asked. And they all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him!" When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and he washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." And all the people answered, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged, and he handed him over to be crucified. Let's pray. Dear God, we acknowledge that it was our sins that brought about Jesus' awful suffering. And like Barabbas, we are the ones who should be punished for our wrongdoing. And like Pilate and those who shouted, "Crucify him," we are guilty of bringing about the death of the author of life. Forgive us, we pray. Cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness and make us whole once again. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our crucified Lord. Amen.
You may remain seated as we sing this hymn, "Beneath the Cross of Jesus."
Yes.
Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him, took his staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. Let us pray. Dear God, like the soldiers who mocked Jesus, we have rejected his lordship through our acts of disobedience and rebellion. And while they did it in mockery, the soldiers that crucified your son were right when they hailed him King of the Jews. Through his life, death, and resurrection, he proved that he is indeed not only the King of the Jews, but the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May our lives, along with our lips, proclaim that Jesus is our Lord and King. By the indwelling presence of your Holy Spirit, help us to live under his rule and reign. In Jesus' name, amen.
As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall, but after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, King of the Jews. Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right, one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who were going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and then we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Pray with me. Dear Father, just as Isaiah prophesied, your Son was the suffering servant of the Lord. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, and yet familiar with suffering. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was assigned a place with the wicked, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was your will to make his life a guilt offering for the sins of the whole world. We are grateful for the sacrifice which Christ made on our behalf on the cross of Calvary. We're forever indebted to you because he bled and died so we might receive your love and mercy. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Amen.
Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. Bleeding from a beating, there were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who'd cry out for his death. Down the soldados le abrían paso a Jesús, mas la gente se acercaba para ver a quien llevaba que la cruz. Por la vía dolorosa es la vía del dolor, como vi a down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of those standing heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open, and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified, and they exclaimed, "Surely, this was the Son of God." Join me in prayer. Most merciful and ever-loving God, we are indeed grateful for your Son Jesus, the light of the world. Without him, we walk in the darkness of sin and death. But with his presence, our path is illumined and our way is made straight. Enable us to be bearers of his light as we seek to allow our lives to shine forth Christ's glory. And this we pray in the name of Jesus, the only true Son of God. Amen. As evening approached, there was a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb, and then he went away.
When they crucify my Lord, sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid his precious body in the tomb? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. In the tomb.